Welcome to our October Supervisors Meeting. I invite you to join the board as we stand and pledge the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, at this time, we have a roll call of the individuals at the front table here.
Melvin Boyd.
Present.
Arthur Zerby.
Here.
Jerry Long.
Here.
Mike Reiner.
Here.
Bill Cassidy.
Here.
Carol Martin.
Okay, at this time, we have an open community session. I try to limit to it for 4 minutes for each person, so you'll get that opportunity to speak. Now, I want you to note, if you want to speak about the local service tax, I have it under the new business, and there'll be an open session at that time to address that. So I'd ask that if you came here to speak in support or in opposition of the local service, you would hold it until we get to that portion, because I'll explain it, and then I'll also open the floor that you can, you'll have an open session at that point. So at this time, it's your opportunity to speak to the board in public, and so we'll give you 4 minutes each. If we have some extra time, we can go around a second time, and then each board member individually will have the opportunity to respond at their discretion to any of your comments and statements. So at this time, is there anyone who would like to address the board? Okay, we'll continue on to, we have two guests here tonight. Our first guest is for Millstone Village Phase 2.
Good evening, my name is Dave Meese, I'm from Beam & Sons, and I'm here to talk to you about the Millstone Village subdivision plan. And so, just by way of background, this is Maple Grove Road here. This is the turnpike on the top of the page. This is the Martin Brothers Builders project that the lots that are in light green are currently in construction or were approved as part of Phase 1. Phase 2 would be the dark green part that extends over towards Sandstone Village on the kind of northwest or northern part of the property here. This would be 15 additional lots in addition to the nine that were already developed as part of Phase 1. You might recall, those of you who were here back in a couple years ago when we got Phase 1 approved, there was a temporary hammerhead put at the end of the street stub here. So that would be removed and the street would be extended through. So we went to the Planning Commission and they gave us a recommendation for a final plan approval. And so we're here to ask the same of you to consider the plan for approval tonight.
What's that? He's trying to get the heater to go.
Oh, for the hammer.
Maybe.
Can you spin it around and show it to the audience? Can you summarize what you said?
Yes. This is the turnpike. This is Maple Grove Road on the right side of the page here. This is where Abbey Lane. Formerly, the end of Abbey Lane was right here. Within the last year, they've been developing these lots up in the light green area here. As part of Phase 2, Abbey Lane will be extended all the way across and tie into the stub that comes off of Sandstone Village on the north side there.
How far are those houses from the turnpike?
The houses are, well, we talked to the Planning Commission about this a little bit. The turnpike right-of-way is 200 feet, and then the rear setback line for the houses is 25 feet, and then most of the houses are setback, or front, I should say, further than that, so probably about at least 35 feet from the right-of-way line of the turnpike.
What are they going to do whenever they widen it?
As part of the preliminary plan, we submitted plans to the Turnpike Commission as part of the normal procedure that the township requires. And at that time, they had no comment about that. It was my understanding that they had no plans of widening the section at that time.
At that time, yes.
Yes.
So what are they going to do in the future whenever the turnpike will be widened, there's no doubt about it, they're already, not just for that section yet, but they will widen it. How's it going to affect those houses?
Same as other houses that exist, I guess, today. Like I said, they have a 200-foot right-of-way there. I'm not sure what their widening plans would be, if they would be taking additional right-of-way or not, or just working within the existing right-of-way.
Mike, you had heard some comment on that, that Turnpike basically feels they can widen the highway within their existing right-of-way.
Right, they have not asked for any additional right-of-way beyond what's already approved. So any improvements that would be done by the Turnpike, they would do within their right-of-way that they already have established. There is an arborvitae landscaping planning requirement that has gone in already.
Yeah, they planted trees all along the
rear of those perimeter lots. And there's also drainage improvements that were done as part of phase one for the stormwater in the lot there. So you have an easement plus a setback requirement from the track boundary. And as Dave said, I mean, they are set back as front as they could be according to zoning. And then obviously, we don't know the intent or the future plans of the Turnpike at this time, but everything would be done within the right-of-way.
So the green line then is right at the 200-foot.
Correct. Yeah,
right away from the Turnpike.
This would be the extent of the 200-foot right-of-way.
They shouldn't be able to put another lane in there, should they?
They should, but I'm not the Turnpike engineer. But there is a bit of topographic change here. I don't know if you can visualize that, but the highway is a bit higher than the backs of these lots right now. So it does kind of drop off kind of steeply at places. So there would be some substantial grading if they determined they were going to grade or, you know, widen in this direction. So, but as Mike pointed out, there's a couple of drain pipes that stick out and drain onto the Millstone Village site that we've, you know, kind of dealt with by constructing a long swale on either side here that feeds towards the main channel across the property.
Whose responsibility will that swale be?
The swale's responsibility would be the individual homeowners.
So there's going to be one long swale and each homeowner will have a portion of it?
Correct.
Will they know that's their responsibility?
Well, as part of the NPS permit and part of the township requirements, we have the stormwater maintenance agreement that will be executed, and that would you know, basically transfer to the property owners once the lots are sold off. So there is the mechanism of them having that having that information presented to them as far as what the maintenance involves. You know, as well as any other plan restrictions or notes that might be included at this point in time.
And you have the recommendations from the Planning Commission to approve the...
Approve it.
Yes. Right, okay. Is there a motion as such?
I make a motion that we approve the Millstone Village Phase 2 as presented.
Okay, I'll second that motion. So we had the motion, it was second to approve phase two. Those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. One comment.
Okay, go ahead.
Probably never anything was said about if the Turnpike ever moves forward, Mike, in the barrier wall? Or was it discussed?
There was no comments from them as far as a barrier wall of any type.
That's one thing that, boy, it'd be nice. I believe someday they're going to finish the Turnpike, another main each way. They're doing it. It'd be nice if we had board on hand. I won't be here, probably. I'll be gone. No, but that would demand to protect, like they did when they went with 222 and a lot of other major roads. They put up the barrier walls to protect the communities. So,
from noise.
Yeah. Yep.
Now, Maple Ridge North has a barrier wall up there just to keep the dirt from coming down, right?
It was just a retaining wall.
Retaining wall, because
of grading there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was a little different. That doesn't necessarily hold back the noise versus the grade, obviously. But
you said as far as grading to put another lane in, all they have to do is go on the other side of Maple Grove Road with the high bank on Greenbrier. They have all the material they want. Just bring it underneath Maple Grove Road. And they can grade it all in. It's all right. Yeah.
If they hire me, I'll get to know that.
Okay.
They won't have to track the truck and car.
Motion carried, so.
Okay, and also.
Yeah, I do have two additional items. One would be the, they're on later in the agenda, but I figure we address them now, would be the stormwater management agreement that Dave had referenced earlier. A motion for that, and also I have a recommendation for the financial security, would be in the amount of $233,783.52.
Would you repeat that?
Yeah, $233,783.52.
And that was for what?
That's for the financial security for the improvements. That would be for the extension of the road and street signs, landscaping, storm sewer, et cetera.
No, they already have financial security for phase one, don't they?
Yeah, still have, yes, correct.
Can that be combined in one motion? Okay.
I make a motion that we accept the stormwater agreement between Brecknock Township and Millstone Village Phase Two.
Okay, I'll second that. So we have the stormwater management agreement, motion and second. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
I make a motion that we accept the financial security in the amount of $233,783.52 between Brecknock Township and Millstone Village Phase Two.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, we had the motion to accept the financial security and it was second. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you all for your time, and I would be remiss if I did not say congratulations to Mr. Zerbe on that prize-winning buck that I would point out I have seen two pictures of from two different people in my office so far. So the word is getting around, Mr. Zerbe. Could I have your autograph, please?
That's my picture.
Was there a developer's agreement?
You want a picture?
It was forwarded to the applicant. They
okay.
Have not.
You didn't want to move one as the season.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, there's one review. Yep.
Oh, you had another one. Oh, did Carol go make some?
Yeah.
I'll take an autograph.
No, you can wait.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, the next guest on our list is from the Adamstown Library Capital Campaign.
Yes, good evening. I promise to be equally as quick as this young man was.
We'll take you. We'll hold you up to it.
I hope I don't hold anyone up. I'm Mike Weatherhole. I'm on the Adamstown Area Library Board of Trustees. And I'm also on the Adamstown Borough Council. I've been on both boards for about 13 years. And with me tonight is our Library Director, Kathy Thren. What I'm going to do tonight is dispense with any of the statistical information, number of programs, number of attendees, and all that type of thing. We do have a copy of our 2016 annual report, I believe, that you may have already received. When you came in the lobby, there's some visual pictures of the proposed layout of that first floor of the building that we purchased, and also the outside facade, although that happened, and I'm sorry, that's not the best rendering I have, but it gives you an idea. The Adamstown Area Library bought the VFW building in Adamstown on Main Street. We bought that at the end of April in 2016. This is all common knowledge. We bought it for $230,000. We, the library, paid $130,000 in cash for it, which we've been saving toward, and the VFW is holding a mortgage or a loan for $100,000 of that $230,000. Heck Construction from Denver is a general contractor, and a gentleman named Lee Olson is from Berks County. He's the architect. We're in the process of firming up the first floor layout and the outside facade. And what we're trying to do is incorporate on the outside the more historical look. I should have made four copies, but I do have a copy here that is at the front table, and it basically shows the Adamstown VFW on the top as it looks today. This is actually a 1960 picture. Hasn't changed a whole lot. And at the bottom is a picture of how that building looked at about 1900. And it had been a hotel for many years. The building itself goes back to 1853, so it's prior to the Civil War. And what we're trying to do is maintain a little bit of that look if we can do it with that front porch area and with shutters. We've kicked off our capital campaign of $1.5 million, and shortly you'll see some large thermometers. I've been talking to Mr. Hoover, Levi Hoover, about a good place to locate one of those in Brecknock Township. We're planning to put these I say thermometers, this is the travel version, the small version, but this is what the thermometer will look like. We plan to put one of these out in each of the five municipalities that the library serves, which is East and West Calico, Denver, Adamstown, and Brecknock Township. And the signs that we're going to put out are 4 foot by 8 foot. They're well constructed. They're going to hold up in the weather. And as we make progress with the campaign, we will obviously increase that red line to show the progress so people driving by, hopefully every day, can see how we're making out with that. Most of the money that's being pledged already, people are going to be pledging over a 3-year period, companies, individuals. And so as a result, at some point, we're going to need to go to the bank and borrow money. We're going to have pledges, hopefully, that will cover what we need to spend, but we don't have the money up front. So we'll go to the bank, but I can guarantee you that under no circumstances at all do we plan to go ahead until we're sure we can handle this project financially. Okay. I mentioned earlier that I'm on the Adamstown Borough Council. I'm well aware, and I've been on the library board for 13 years too, I'm well aware of all the financial struggles that all the municipalities face, including the library board. We work on a very tight budget, and as I know many of the municipalities do as well. The Adamstown Area Library has been very fortunate. We've had great support over the years from all five municipalities. And obviously some municipalities are in better shape than others maybe to work with us on this project. But that's certainly not for me to say. I got my own concerns being an Adamstown Borough Council person as far as budgets and all that type of thing go. What I can tell you though, and I believe this from the bottom of my heart, that libraries are an important quality of life service to all of our communities. I think people who move into an area want to know, number one, they want to know how good is the school system, and number two, often is are there libraries, and so it's an important service. I personally believe it really adds to our property values. It's one of those things that's hard to see, but you go into a community and you see the fire companies that are there and the libraries that are there and the school system that's there. It all has to positively affect our property values. What I suggest you do, if you're not familiar with a library, is go to the library, and I say this to anybody who's in the room who's never been to the library, go to the library, grab a newspaper, sit there for an hour or two and just watch what goes on. I could sit here all night and tell you stories, but I can tell you stories about people who come into the library, adults in several cases who could not read, and they came in and they were helped to read. They had volunteers who worked with them over a period of time and have really improved their reading skills. I know people who have come in who had help with their resume. Number one, filling out a resume, and in some cases they needed to know a certain skill. They needed to know how to use Word or how to use Excel to get a job. And they've come back, tearfully, saying to us they were so thankful because they got help and they got a job. What I see, and I'm in the library fairly frequently, Kathy's there every day, I see kids that come in, and many, many kids come in, and it's fun to watch them. They'll come in and they'll leave literally with a bag of books. And the interesting thing is that they'll be back next week getting another bag of books. Okay? It's just, you see this repeated over and over again. It's one of those things that when you see it, you think, if nothing else, that in and of itself is a good reason to support the library. Many of us, I'm one of those people, I have a computer at home, I'm hooked up to the internet, and quite frankly, although I'm not a big reader, if I wanted to, I could go out and buy a bestseller and read it. A lot of people can't do that. They don't have the internet, they don't have a computer maybe. We see a lot of kids that come in who are doing schoolwork using the computers at the library. So we serve a lot of needs that many of us don't even think about or don't see every day. I know that Mr. Zerbe, Mr. Boyd, and former supervisor Mr. Wise are familiar with the Adamstown Library. I know you've been there over the years. I know you've presented programs over the years. It wasn't too many years ago that there was a challenge from the Lancaster County Commissioners, okay, where they were going to match, forget if it was the 1-for-1 or 2-for-1, and if municipalities gave X number of dollars, say the municipality said, well, we'll give another $1,000 to the library, then the commissioners said, well, we'll add another $1,000 on top of that, or $2,000 for every $1,000 you give. Mr. Zerbe was, quite frankly, one of the people who spoke up back then and was instrumental in getting a larger donation to the Adamstown Area Library. And number one, we didn't forget it. Number two, it set the bar for what other people and other municipalities did. I've been to enough municipal meetings, both in Adamstown and other municipalities, to know this. When an issue comes up, be it the library or any number of things, it seems like the only people you see here are the ones who are against it, okay? There'll be a vocal group of 10 or 15 people who don't want you to build a new fire company or whatever the issue may be. And what I always find interesting about that is that in our case with the library, I'm an accountant by background, so I like to do numbers. I'm going to bore you with one number. Over the last 5 years, Brecknock Township patrons have taken out 41,000, more than, but average, 41,000 items per year from the Adamstown Library. That's books and CDs and books on tape and what have you. I'm not talking about any programs or any of that. You have that kind of volume, and you say to yourself, I do. Who are the people that are taking out 41,000 items? I mean, there's a lot of kids, obviously, but there's a lot of adults, too. And why aren't they here saying, hey, you know, continue to support the library, okay? I think the reason they're not here, and this is true in any municipality you go into, the reason they're not here is because they believe that the people sitting at the front desk, much like I do in Adamstown, will do, I don't want to say the right thing, but they trust us to make the right decision. Frankly, I am trusting you guys also to make the right decision to continue the support of the library as you have in the past. I probably exceeded my 5 minutes. I got off on a tangent or two there, but I'll be happy to answer any questions I can, and I'm sure Kathy would too. So thank you for your time.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, you have the minutes in your binder. Are there any corrections and additions? Oh, okay.
Any comments?
Would anyone like to address anything or talk to the people representing the library? Okay, sorry. Okay, we'll move on to minutes. Are there any additions or corrections to the minutes as posted?
I read the minutes and I make a motion to approve them.
I second it.
Okay, we had the motion to approve and second the minutes as posted. Those in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries. You have the bills.
I make a motion we pay the bills in the amount of $42,104.75.
I second it.
Okay, we had a motion to approve the bills and it was second. Those in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries. Okay, we have the reports. We have the roadmaster's report on your binder. Does anyone have anything they want to add or ask?
I don't know if you want to address that or not at this point.
Yeah, I think we should. Can you explain what, Mr. Baum, can you explain what you're asking the LTAP to study for Edwards Road?
Edwards Road has a very steep grade. I measured it. It is a 20% grade on it. And it was brought to my attention that there is no sign warning people of the steep grade. And any trucks going down the hill, vehicles, anybody, you know, who's unfamiliar, especially with Maple Grove close by, have no idea how steep that hill actually is. And I talked to LTAP. I thought maybe they would do a study for us to see if it's eligible to have a warning sign put up for how steep the hill is. They said they don't actually do the study for us, but they would help us through it. I don't know what the study entails or how long it takes or anything like that, but before I move forward on it.
Well, I guess it's a township road and the signs would be the township's responsibility. Is there any reason to can't just get some signs and put up?
From what I'm told, you have to have a study done.
Yeah, that's correct. You would normally have to do a study, an engineering study, Mr. Long. And what that would entail, that could be as simple as a site visit by a traffic engineer, which I work with a traffic engineer. I could look, if the board would like me to look into that, I could find out how much it would cost, what it would entail. I don't know the specific criteria for that posting, but there would normally have to be some background engineering done, at least a site visit with some calculations done on the grade, perhaps. And that might be the extent of it, in order to post and enforce, you know, post the signs and then enforce them if there would be an enforcement process. Typically, there's a, for posting of a road, for example, for weight limits, that would be an example of enforcement, you know, based on an engineering study.
Give me an idea of traffic counts on that road.
Less than 500 a day?
Yeah, I would say
low volume.
500 or less, yeah.
Okay.
The question comes in, where you say enforcement? This isn't a thing of any enforcement. This would be a thing of
warning.
Just a cautionary sign.
No, correct. I don't disagree. And when I said that, I was referring to whenever you post signs, typically there's an enforcement component. This would merely just be a warning issue. I can touch base with LTAP and find out exactly. What they normally do is they'll advise us as far as what would be required. They may not necessarily move forward with the actual recommendation, like, as a typical traffic engineer would do, or another engineer.
So you're looking for direction whether we'd like you to move forward or just...
Right. You either move forward or just let it go.
Yeah. Thoughts?
How long's the road been there?
Long time.
Long time.
Well, I remember when I was a teenager, it was a logging road. You couldn't drive a vehicle through, so... it's only been in place probably 40 years. Before that, it was 40-something years.
What, is there any reason the length of time has something to do with it?
It is steep.
It is steep.
Everybody that drives it already knows.
Well, he is mentioning Maple Grove. There are a few people that sneak out that way. And the poor fella that's never been in our area from New York or New Jersey, if that thing on your internet tells you to take that route to get to Morgantown and he's being by a big camper going down over there, they're getting bigger all the time. He could be in trouble when he tops that, depends if he's going a little too fast.
Okay, I guess I would...
Bicycle riders.
True.
And you're completely unaware.
I would say let's pursue it and see what kind of cost it could involve.
Okay.
To me, it should just be an engineer to say, look.
It could be as basic as a site visit art.
And
we're talking about an hour site visit plus a small recommendation.
You need a sign that says steep slope.
Very, very inexpensive, but I can confirm that.
Okay. Any progress on your new overhead doors?
Levi's been handling that. The last time I talked to him, I thought he said they were at about 2 to 3 weeks out.
Should hear something soon.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Nothing else for the roadmaster. We have the engineer's report.
Okay. You have a copy of my report of October 7. I have summarized the items requiring board action for you on page 4 and 5,
okay.
And I'll just read those quickly unless the board has other questions within my report. Item number 1 was Millstone Village Phase 2, which we've already taken care of earlier this evening. Item 2 is a financial security recommendation for Lowell Sensenig in the amount of $2,332.25. Item 3 is Javon Horse Stormwater Management Plan. Is accepting a memorandum of understanding for that stormwater project. Item 4 is Curvin Beachy Stormwater Management. That's a release recommendation in the amount of $4,275. Item 5 is Brecknock Builders Land Development. That's for a recommendation to establish financial security in the amount of $30,011.30. also to accept the stormwater management agreement and developers agreement. Item number six is 1188 Redding Road Lot Add-on Plan. That's a memorandum of understanding with Pine Grove Mennonite Church. Does the board have any questions related to any of those items?
Did we make a motion to cover them all?
Yes.
Yeah.
I think we did, didn't we?
Yes. Yes.
I make a motion that on the basis of our engineer's recommendation that we allow all of these to pass.
I second it.
Okay, the motion was made and second to approve and take action as recommended. Those in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay, we have the
Jerry, we have that Park and Rec volunteer right behind all Mike's stuff, right in front of
the business. Okay, let's do that next. You're talking about the application for the...
Yep, it's right in front of the old business tab.
Okay, we had an application for someone to join as a volunteer for the Park and Rec, and was approved by the Park and Rec Committee, so is there a motion to appoint this person?
I'll happily make that motion that we appoint Burton Greeby as a member of the Park and Rec Board.
I second it.
Okay, the motion was made to appoint Burton Greedy and second. Those in favor say aye.
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 It's difficult to get anybody to volunteer for any board, let alone Park and Rec.
Motion carries.
What role does that involve for Park and Rec? What do they do? What, is it like maintenance for the fields? Or?
Yes, go ahead, Arthur can explain.
Okay. What it entails is there's issues that the Park and Rec Board feels might be safety issues. They'll bring them to the attention of the roadmaster. He will then look at those. It has nothing for you that you do any maintenance or anything. It's also something when you feel you need a new piece of equipment or something, or you come through with a new idea. It's also for... And hopefully someday our park is large enough, it could entertain some pretty large events. Be nice if the Park and Rec Board someday would come forward with some events that not just Brecknock Township, but a large regional area could come to enjoy. I keep looking at Terry Hill Park. Their park isn't very big. Look at all the things they do with that park. One thing after another. We have the facilities to do so much more if we could just get everything organized and ideas would come forward. And that's why it's nice to have new people come on the board, too, with new ideas. Yeah, there's plenty of room to do things, so.
Okay, thank you. We have our SEO and zoning reports in your packet, and does anything from the solicitor?
Not this time.
Okay. Is there approval of the reports?
I make a motion that we approve the reports from the roadmaster, engineer, SEO, and zoning as presented.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, we had the motion to approve the reports, and it was second. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Now, did I see something from the Park and Rec?
Yes.
Just 10 minutes.
Okay. Okay, we'll move on to old business, which is the local service tax.
I have a problem with that. That is not old business. Last meeting, you made a motion to table the subject and the discussion, and it failed to pass, so it cannot be old business.
Well, let me explain. Based upon the support from local businesses and the fire companies, I was encouraged to put it back on the agenda, which we have on the agenda.
You could put it on the agenda. You can only put it on the agenda under new business, and you can't put it on now because it did not have the support of the majority of the supervisors at the last meeting to continue it to this meeting.
I don't know if it needed the support of the supervisors.
It certainly
placed
did.
On the agenda.
You made the motion and it failed.
Let's ask legal counsel.
I think it can be brought up independently of
under old business.
Under new business. Under new business.
But it's not on the agenda under new business.
Understood. I mean, I think the topic can be raised as a general subject under new business.
Well, then it's not under old business.
Correct.
What is the procedure to?
We just move it down to the new business.
Okay. Does that require any action?
No. Just go to the new business portion of the meeting.
Okay. We will move the local service topic from old business.
The Adamstown Borough sign.
What is this?
Oh yes, you're right. Thanks, Bill. It's right behind. Levi is. The sign for the Adamstown Library that they would like to put up in the township. Mike had come and talked to Levi about a permit for that sign. It would require a permit, but Levi's recommending that we waive the fee for them for that sign. Thank
yeah, I would suggest that based upon Levi Hoover's approval and the roadmaster's approval.
Well, I guess they have to have approval from us to do it.
They do. Yes, to waive the fee.
Yes, to waive the permit they're asking for.
Oh, okay.
I make a motion that we waive the fee for the Adamstown Library to put their sign wherever they're going to put it in the township.
I'm still working with Levi on that.
Yeah.
No, I'll second that motion.
Okay. The motion was made and second to give permission and waive the permit fee for Adamstown Library. And it was second, so those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thanks. Thanks, Bill.
Sure. Okay, so then we have nothing under old business, and we'll move on to new business. Okay. The local service tax issue has come up in anticipating next year's budget process. And basically one of the hardest things to budget and prepare for is our road costs. Over the years, the township has consistently budgeted less than what we've been spending on our roads. And so as I tried to determine what it actually costs to maintain roads, I did research, I talked to neighboring townships, but the bottom line is we have the historical data right here, what it costs to maintain our 58 miles of township road. We have the historical data for the last 15 years, what it costs. This shouldn't be a difficult thing to know what to budget in for 2017, what it would cost to maintain our roads. We know that. So I looked at the historical data, and it varies year to year, but I broke it into a five-year segment, determined an average five-year, another five-year, another five-year, and it's very consistent. Basically, over these course of times, we pretty much established there is an average cost to maintain and rebuild and our 58 miles of township roads. That average cost is approximately $375,000. This past year, which the budget was approved by the previous board, there was $238,000 budgeted, and the roadmaster had to take some roads off a list that he had to do, wanted to do tar and chip, because we held him to our budget. And I think this board should try to always stick to a budget and stay within it. But most of the years in the past 10 years, we have not stuck to that budget, and we've constantly drawn off of our capital surplus over those years and have depleted it substantially. Now, as I try to propose a budget for next year, something that is reliable and gives any possibility, it has to be in that $375,000 a year range. Now, our revenue will not support that currently. So what means do we have as a township to increase our revenue, maintain our responsibility to our local emergency service providers, and maintain our roads? I think our roads have been maintained well the past 12, 18 years. We know what it costs to do that. And if we expect our road crew to continue the program that they've been taught, we know what that cost is. And we don't have the revenue to do it. So an attempt to look at the revenue side, which we're very limited to, is property tax increases, which is be very difficult to come up with, you know, that the difference in cost. Basically, the difference is in the neighborhood of $100,000 revenue that we're short. Or look at the local service tax, which is a replacement from the occupational privilege tax. Now, the majority of townships in Lancaster County, a huge majority, have all gone to the local service tax years ago. The local service tax has requirements on how it's used. It must be used for local services, emergency services, and some road work. This would just simply supplement some of our current costs that we put into the local services, and it would allow us to have more revenue to maintain our roads. Otherwise, if we continue the same trend that we've been on, in 3-4 years, we will have no capital reserve. And so the challenge for us coming into next year is to establish a budget that maintains the level of support for our local fire companies and emergencies, plus give our road crew the funds they need to maintain the roads. And we know what that's going to cost, and we're being a fool to give them less than that and expect them to do the same level of service that we've come to expect from our road crew. So I propose that we look at adopting the local service tax, which is applied just to employees that work in the township. People in the township that do not work here, they pay it on the township they work in. And like I say, probably 98% of them are paying the top amount of $52. The legislator sets a limit on that. And that's maintained by them. We cannot exceed that, and we'll never be able to do it unless it's raised across the board. We currently are still in the $10 occupational privilege tax, which goes entirely to the school board. We can adopt or enable the local service tax and set that rate to whatever this board would decide. It does not have to be the $52, but in an effort to make any impact on increasing our revenue to cover our expected costs for next year, it would be, you know, I'm suggesting that we would need to go the $52.
I have a question.
Let me open up. Or would you wait? Can you wait till we? Mm-hmm. Okay. So that's what this all is all about. Now the other thing, it's a timing thing. We would have to notify the county by December 1st if we want to do it next year. If we miss that date, then we don't do it. We do not do it. The expected revenue from going to local service tax, if we have 2,000 employees in our township, then we would raise approximately $94,000 additional revenue. That would be a huge boost to our roads. If we don't do that, we'll continue to draw upon our capital reserves until there's nothing, or else let our roads go to nothing, or else cut back on our level of support for the our local emergency responders. So I put it on the agenda last month just to bring it up for discussion, and I was challenged and had to defend it, and I wasn't prepared to defend it. And I was shortly after that meeting, I was approached by a number of businesses, the largest businesses in the township, that recommended we put it back on the agenda, because if we cannot keep our township solvent and sustainable, everybody loses. And so it's back on the agenda to talk about and possibly to move forward on it would be to have the solicitor prepare an ordinance. And it would have to be advertised, and then after the advertisement, then we would actually have to make the final decision. So tonight is not a final decision on the actual thing. It would just be a decision to move forward and prepare the ordinance and put it up for advertisements. Now, I said there would be an open session. I welcome anyone who has any questions or wants to add any comments concerning this.
Question.
Yeah.
Are we saying that since this is a service tax, that we're going to give more money to our bar companies? Or are we just going to replace the money that we're already giving them with this new revenue? So their revenue is going to stay the same.
Well, that's a decision we'll make. But basically, at this point...
It's a very important decision that we need to talk about right now.
Well,
are we going to increase... If we're going to increase the money to the fire companies, that's great. But if we're going to continue to give them the same amount, and we're going to use this new money... A portion of which, how much is it? 50%?
It's 25%.
25% is supposed to go to the fire company. They should be getting 25% more than what they're currently getting. And I also disagree totally that our roads are in the condition. I think if we work within a consortium, we can have these roads back in shape in no time. I don't think we need a tax increase.
Let me just follow up. I asked the neighboring township to the southeast of us in Lancaster County what their budget is. And again, I earlier said that we have our own record. We don't need to know it, but just to share it with the group. Carnarvon Township has a road budget of between $350,000 and $400,000 every year to maintain 38 miles of roads. We budget $240,000 for 58. We expect to maintain the same level of quality roads as it don't add up. It doesn't add up. I'm a numbers guy. It doesn't add up.
They spend their money on trucks and other types of equipment that we do not have. Sure, they spend the money. They have the money, and they spend it. I mean, they go around every year cleaning out the ditches. All the ditches along all the roads. They have a sweeper, a vacuum. They have all kinds of things that we don't have.
Let's ignore them. Let's just talk about what it has cost us the past 15 years. What the average cost it has cost us each year for the past 15 years.
To maintain a road.
To maintain a road. We know that. That's the $375,000 a year.
Uh-huh.
There was, yes.
Well, I was just going to say, and we haven't even touched on future planning. Because at some point, we're going to need more police protection. We keep adding more developments, we keep adding more people, we keep seeing a lot more things going on right in front of our houses, and it takes a long time for state police to come. At some point, there's going to be a day of reckoning with police protection, and it doesn't sound to me like there's anything being planned for that coming up. And that issue, if it's not already here, is coming.
Well, this tax has nothing.
Excuse me a minute. Whether we choose to share that with the township, neighboring township, or whatever, but that issue is here now, and it doesn't sound like there's any planning for what it's going to look like when we add these four new developments that are in the works.
You're exactly right. There is no planning for that. If you had any idea of what the other townships are spending for police protection, and it's like Arthur said at the last meeting, we can't even raise our taxes high enough to get police protection.
I understand that, and I do know what the other townships are paying for police protection. And I'm not saying we need our own set of police officers, but there's a lot of creative sharing going on, and I know Brecknock Township in Berks is open to that kind of discussion. So I think we can't just say we're going to all be safe, life is going to keep on going well, when we have serious issues going on now. So, you know, yes, we have
the importance of fire company, absolutely. But we also need protection when we're walking the streets. We also need protection to enforce the township rules that we have. We have township rules and no one to enforce them.
That's correct. And the cost of a police department or even sharing, almost all of our surrounding municipalities spend over $500,000 a year on protection. And that's with a regional.
So that means that we do not plan.
That means that we can't even raise the taxes high enough. Arthur will tell you that.
But at some point, we need to start planning. What are we heading our community towards?
Well, if you look at the police log that's in the daily paper, almost never is anything in there from Brecknock.
It's inaccurate. There are so many things. I know personally because I saw things that never showed up in the police report. Never showed up. Three things this week that never showed up in the police log. It's not accurate. And it's because we do not have a police force that's representing us.
Do you think we should have a police force?
Not an entire force. I mean, when you look at our budget, I mean, here we are, we're already struggling and we don't have any police officers other than the state police.
Okay. But this tax we're talking about has nothing whatsoever to do with that.
Indirectly it does, because we're talking about reserves as well, rebuilding reserves. And right now we're depleting reserves, as I understand it.
No.
We're not depleting reserves?
No.
In the past 12 years, we've averaged...
We've had more money in the past.
Let me talk. In the past 12 years, we've averaged a deficit of $114,000 a year. We depleted our general reserve by over $1 million in the past 12 years.
So you're saying 12 years ago, we had how much money?
$1 million more than we do now.
So we had $1.5 million.
Look, I'm not here to bash the past. I'm trying to say we have a revenue problem in the township. We have a revenue problem. We're growing, we're increasing, and most of our cost, our major cost in the township has to do with our roads and maintaining our emergency medical responders support. You asked me the question earlier if this will increase it. This tax is meant to guarantee the same level of support for our emergency medical responders.
So they're not going to get more money?
It's to guarantee the same level of support so that we
can... You are using this tax and saying this is for services, and it really is not that.
No,
that's
it
what
is.
You're saying.
It is.
No, it's
this
not.
This tax will not equal the $105,000 we gave to the local emergency first responders.
They should be getting another 25%.
Well, I agree, but we're not going to pull it out of capital or reserves every year.
Now, what I want to know is, are you going to give it from this new tax that you're putting on? You're going to give them another 25% of this tax.
We can't
afford. You said $100,000 or about.
We can't afford to give what we're given.
Oh, what do you mean? We can't afford.
I'm saying we can't afford to.
No.
To put our road budget where it needs to be. And we didn't even talk about truck replacement costs. When I said $375,000 to maintain the roads, that does not include truck replacement costs. It does not include the MS4 requirements. It does not include all the unfunded mandates that are coming down from the federal government with no funds with them that we are required to pick up the slack and pay for them. It does not include that. It's a downhill spiral. This is simply something to look at what the other townships are doing and saying, look, we're at a place where we're going to have to simply do the same thing and help support our, keep our township solvent and sustainable.
My turn?
Yes, please.
Okay. I can see where both of these are coming from. The thing is, and if Carol don't mind, I'll put you on the spot. We get a lot generated less through the local tax than we did years ago. We're getting less money, is that correct?
Through the earned income.
Yeah.
Well, we have been maintaining a very healthy, it was low for a while, And yes, it is up now, and it's because of the reporting that the Lancaster County Tax Collection Bureau went to. We used to get quarterly, it was a collection thing. We now get constant monthly payments from them, which has really changed.
And the liquid fuel money has...
Well, that has definitely, that went dropped off significantly, but now it has picked up a little bit, but not, you know...
Where it was.
No, I mean, we are getting back, we're getting close, but I mean, yes, we had dropped off earned income, but now we are, we're very healthy when it comes to the earned income, but...
Where are we losing the most capital? Do you know, offhand? Just, it was a little bit of everywhere.
Yeah, I mean, it is, and it's, we've been maintaining a healthy, over the last, I would say, 5 years, income. However, we've had, and Mike can also confirm this, stormwater management, our MS4, our Act 537 online maintenance program, these are all things that we are mandated to do with no additional funds to do it.
The cost of everything keeps going higher.
Right.
Now, if we could get Mike to cut his wage in half, we'd be a little better. But anyway, this is, to me, I thought about it. This is not a tax that is imposed just not on our people. This is a tax on the people that come in here to work. My wife works in East Cocalico. She doesn't like that she pays a dollar every week out of her pay. That goes to East Cocalico. There is no benefit to her. There is no benefit to this township. We have a lot of people that come into this township for employment. I don't know if I should say this. Brubacher's is one of them. What, 700 employees or something? Most of them are outsiders. We're paying tax, this $1 a week tax, to their municipality, but we don't get nothing from them. And, you know, beside the point where the money's going at this point, between what Mel's bringing up, I am at the position now to fully support this, because this is not the time to discuss where the money is going. That's the time for the budget. Correct? Mm-hmm. It'll go into the budget. Mm-hmm. The budget will be the next month or two.
Yep.
And then we sit down and we discuss the budget and where the money's going. But we do need, we don't want to get in a hole. And maintaining the roads, when you have less money all the time, it's tough. You know.
The other thing that has really impacted our budget over the last several years is winter maintenance.
Yeah.
The cost of salt is huge. I mean, it was up for the longest time, and it's unbelievable. You wouldn't imagine what we pay for salt and cinders in this township. It would blow your mind. And that has been a huge impact on our budget over the last several years.
Unless you have a job in this township, this tax will not affect you at all. Not one penny.
But there's a lot of people who have jobs in this township that live in this township. As a matter of fact, it will unequitably impact the plain people in this township.
There is a set amount, which is
$12,000. It has to be over $12,000. But there's an awful lot of Mennonite and Amish contractors in this township. They're going to have to pay it.
Have you talked to any of them?
No, I have not talked to them.
I have.
And they want it.
They're
right?
In favor of it.
Oh, yeah, they love it. I'm sure.
They support it. Specifically from
if
one.
If the fire company gets the extra 25%, okay. But they're not. You just want the extra money.
This is not a want. This is a need.
No, it's not a want.
Right now, if we do not have any increase in revenue, mm-hmm. our 2017 budget will basically reflect our 2016, and we'll have $240,000 for the road again. They'll be cutting roads again from the list, and they'll be pushing stuff off. There'll be no savings toward future projects that require overlays. We've had developments that go on, and a question for Arthur, when a developer puts in a new development, puts in a street, you know, he puts a base coat, he puts a top coat, how many years basically is that road pretty much, you know, it's not the township's burden. It's not the township's patching on it yet. How many years does it take until the township has to start doing crack control and sealing it and this and that.
I've seen Village Circle up here. It didn't even go 5 years.
So, they all increased the cost of our roads.
That evidently wasn't done to spec.
Well, they had the inspectors out there from.
Well, that wasn't done.
It didn't matter.
Not your firm.
No, I was going to say it was.
No, not your firm. It was Spots.
But we picked up the tab. We need to pick up the tab. How many years ago is all Raybill's development put in? I drove through there the other day and I thought, you know, these roads are getting to the point where they need major work. Black Creek Road, past the Black Creek Greenhouse, that road is beyond tar and chip. We need a couple years like we've had in the past where we spend $800,000 a year on road maintenance and repair.
The last
Silver
2 years.
Road's the same way. Silver Hill.
Well, it's becoming there's no revenue.
Whereabouts in Silver Hill?
No, isn't that Silver Hill beside Yellow Hill?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. That,
back past
oh,
Uber.
Boy.
Back
yeah.
past Uber.
That's probably the worst one in Brecknock.
Yeah, yes. You're right.
That road was done about 20 years ago, real well, maybe 18 or 20 years ago.
I think Arthur did an excellent job running the road program for all these years, and we know what it costs. We're fooling ourselves to put our head in the sand and say we can do it for half of that. And I want his methods, his procedures to continue. And I want the new road crew to have success.
Well, I will say this. In order for the fire company to keep getting their money, in order for the day to look for maybe some police protection, in order to keep the roads in shape that the roadmaster has money, we have to come up with a little bit more revenue. Let the people coming in here.
I think the last 2 years, we've done wonders on the roads. And that was the first time, the last 2 years, that we have used tar and chip, which we should have been using for years before.
Okay, in 2014, we ran a deficit of $355,000. In 2015, last year, we ran a deficit of $47,000. When I say a deficit,
I don't understand what you mean by deficit.
It means we pulled that money out of the general reserve to cover our costs. That's what
it means. Cost of what?
To do business as a township. We exceeded our budget that we had.
Where are these general reserves that you're talking about?
They're in if you could read a budget each year.
Yes,
the budget
I'm looking at our financial information right here, and you're saying hundreds of thousands of dollars we're losing. Where's it coming from?
It came out of our general reserve.
Well, I can see what we have for here. Where are these reserves you're talking about? Are they different?
He's talking about monies that weren't designated for expenses. If you look at the balance sheet when you get the budget, it would show you the unappropriated funds, which is our general carryover each year. You know, you take your income and your expenses, and we spent more than we brought in that current year. But we had extra money left over that we keep carrying over. That's what he's talking about.
Now you're saying we're spending more than we're taking in from the earned income tax and from the state now.
That's exactly
what you're saying.
That's what I'm saying.
Yes.
I find that difficult to believe.
It's true, Mel.
And not only that, if we had been doing the roads the way we're doing them the last 2 years in the past, we wouldn't be doing this problem. We wouldn't have this problem. Instead of skin patching.
Let's not make too much personal here. We identified our problem and we're trying to fix, not. Okay.
I started working on roads in 1968, Adamstown Borough under Gene Besler. And I've seen where the oil and chip has taken us for many years. We oil and chip. We lost our profile. You can only take oil and chipping so far, and then you need a complete overlay. I agree with that.
But first of all, you have to tar and chip to get the roads back into some kind of condition that you can do an overlay.
Not necessarily.
Instead of just patching and going around and crack sealing, if you had just done tar and chipping for the last 10 years or whatever it is, we would be in a position now we could start doing overlays.
We'd have the bumpiest, lumpiest, lumpiest road you'd ever imagine. Silver Hill wouldn't be the only bad road. We'd have bad roads all over this township. Do you realize we overlaid in the last 12 years, I think it's 27 different roads in this township. Those are roads that don't need no oil and chip for a while.
Oh, I agree.
You know, we tried to bring our roads back. I wish we had enough money to give the roadmaster that he could overlay the roads instead of oil and chip. It would be a big plus, but...
And you know the difference in cost between oil and chip and overlay, right?
I know, but you don't build, you don't straighten out the profile, you don't get rid of the drainage, you're cleaning ditches over and over. There's a lot more involved than just oil and chip. It's the services you have to do to that road to keep them maintained.
All right, I'm done.
I just say, we have the historical data to tell us exactly what it has cost. We know what it is, we're a fool not to acknowledge it, and we're a fool not to budget accordingly so that we can continue it. And to do that, we require us to increase revenue, and this is one small step, and hopefully it can, you know, start us in a path of...
One small step. What's the next step?
You said you were done. To plan for the future, to plan for the protection this township needs. And again, I don't have the answers tonight, but I'm not going to stop trying.
And for information for the people, this does not... This is not for people who collect Social Security. You know, it's for working people that come in here. And there are some people that live in this township that are employed here, but it's a dollar a week is what it comes to.
Is there any other comments from the group? Yes.
I'm looking at the budget for this year, and we ended 2015 with equity funds, which I think you're calling capital reserve, of $328,000. The budget projects that we're ending this year with $448,000, which is a $120,000 increase. It's not negative spending.
Because this year we made him stick to the budget. We took streets off his list. This year we were fortunate the weather wasn't as bad. This year it looks like we're gonna maintain our costs and stay within our revenue. But this year we only gave the $240,000 instead of the $375,000, which we know is gonna be an average cost. So right there should be $140,000 that we should have saved for future road work.
Well, then it would have been more than $120,000 positive.
Possibly. But I'm looking at a trend that next year, potentially, we would need the 375 plus the 100 we didn't have this year for our roads. I don't know if there's no other comments from the group of in support or opposition.
I'll just say something quick, just to kind of go from the fire side of the aspects of things. There's a certain requirement the township requires as far as any kind of protection, whether or not it be police protection, fire protection. The one thing is for the classification of the township, which we're a second class township, if I'm correct, we're required to have a certain amount of fire apparatus per the community. Okay, in that fire apparatus, obviously things have changed. Everybody's noted that the budget has changed and everything else. 20 years ago, these fire apparatus you could get for roughly about $100,000. This year and 2 years ago, we replaced the tanker. That tanker cost $550,000. Okay. Our funding really, and I'll be quite honest with you, we hear about the more houses and everything else, which is great for the community, but when the new houses come in, it tends to draw people from the outside area that may have been in. And I don't want to profile anybody, but in the city area where they already have a fire tax, okay? So you have a fire tax, you're coming to our community, and, you know, we provide a service to our community members, and unfortunately, they may not be aware that there is no fire tax. We send out mailings for fundraising, you know, and not only that, but the times have changed where... You want to be a member, and right away we just give you a pair of boots and a bunker coat and say, hey man, you're trained. You can go into a burning building. The hours and hours of training that each one of our members have to go through just to provide the level of service to the community has gone up greatly. We have not only endured many fundraising hours, but also training hours. which we provide to the township every year at the end of the year, and I'm sure you guys have checked that trend as well, that it has definitely increased. So in response, I feel as though some days we become, yes, we're still a fire company, but we're also professional fundraisers.
You have to
be. You know, we have to be on the backside of it, which, you know, and as far as the community goes, if you don't have a fire service, this $52 has nothing to do with it. Your homeowner's insurance, there's an ISO rating that we need to fall into in order to make sure that people's homeowner's insurance stays down. So without the fire, and not even police, it's just the fire, homeowner's insurance would go through the roof. So as far as I'm concerned, the $52, I pay it. It goes Manheim Township. And I see the buildings and the fire apparatus that they have, and that's great because they're definitely set. And as far as how I feel about it for our township, I feel as though we ought to do it.
Thank you.
Because I'll be quite honest with you, I spend a lot of time up at the firehouse where I can be at home with my 5-year-old and my 14-year-old and my wife doing other things.
Yeah, and for the record, and I'll use the Bowmansville Fire Company as an example. The township provides about 30% of their funding that they need for each year. They, as a firefighter, have to do their own training. They have to come out and put all that volunteers. Plus, they have to raise in fundraising approximately 50% of their operating costs. We give them 30%. They get another 20% through renting out the hall and their tables and chairs and this, what they get through the state and grants, and they also get something from the turnpike. But some townships, they'll match their fire companies in their dollar-per-dollar fundraising. So Bowmansville's operating costs, the budget is about $150,000. We give them $45,000 a year. They have to raise $80,000 of their own. So not only do we expect them to volunteer all their time and their training, they have to raise their own money. I wish that we were in a position that we could support them more. I would be glad to increase their contribution $20,000, but we don't have the revenue, and I'm just trying tonight to make one small step in increasing that revenue, and the end result is our continued level of support to them. Is there anyone else who wants to make comments? Well, if not, I'll make a motion that the board would continue this process of implementing the LS local service tax and ask the solicitor to prepare
an ordinance.
An ordinance that we would then advertise and set a date in November before the final date is due, and that we could provide notice to the town, to the county, that our township would desire to implement the LS. Again, that decision wouldn't be made till after it's advertised appropriately, and we would meet again.
Well, you say at another meeting. You talking about the November regular meeting?
No, whatever. I think you had mentioned that because this meeting is as late in the month, and the one in November is as early as possible in the month.
There's only 26 days between.
That you might not have enough time to get.
I'd have to get the advertisement in Thursday. At noon.
And if that doesn't happen, we would have to set a special meeting later in November.
That's correct.
And then we would actually vote.
Yeah, you'd have to have a meeting
yeah.
Where you'd have advertisement 3 times prior to that date, with the last one being not less than 7 days before, and the first one has to be at least 21 days before the hearing date.
Yeah.
So we'd have to take a look at calendar to determine, and you should determine that this evening. If you're not going to do it at our regular meeting, you should make that determination tonight, so have a date certain and a time certain.
Well, the question would be to you. If you can do it in time, we would do it at our regular meeting. If you can't, then we should schedule it.
What amount are you talking about? The imposition of the tax, $52?
$52.
Okay, just you understand that part of that will be shared with the school district.
$5 will be shared with the school district.
Yeah.
The $47 would come to the township.
Yeah, it's my understanding.
Yeah.
And I will verify that. That's okay. The one issue that I need to clarify. It's either going to be 5 or 10. So you'd either get 42 or 47.
Okay.
And the school district would get 10 or 5.
they are currently have been collecting $10. I'm not sure if it's occupational privilege tax or no, or how that stays stated, but it'll be one of those two. And I could get that done, you know, for November, if that's what you want to do, but if not.
Do you you say you do have enough time to do it?
I'll make sure, if you want it done by then, we will get it done. My secretary will be on overdrive. No, we can get that done.
Well, I put a motion on the floor. Is there a second or comments?
I second it.
Okay.
I have a comment.
Make your comment.
I don't raise taxes, and I don't rezone ag.
Okay.
May I make a comment there?
Sure. We're in the comment mode.
Okay. When the day comes, should you be sitting there as supervisor, and there is no more building lots, and there is no more industrial or commercial land available, if you don't rezone ag, where are you going to take the land from to provide these zoning issues? Because if you don't rezone, somebody can come into this township, ask for anything they want, any place they want, pertaining industrial, commercial, or residential, petition the court, and they'll get it granted automatically. You have to provide for all types of zoning. So you have to be careful there what you say and what you do, because you could get this township into a liability issue that could cost us a lot.
Okay, let's move on. I agree with you, but there was a motion and it was second. I'd like to move on the
vote. When you said you don't rezone ag.
Until we have to.
Come on.
No.
Come on. Okay, we had a motion. It was second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No. Opposed.
Motion carries. Okay, next we have the Bowmansville Fire Company Game Dinner. One of the largest fundraisers for the Bowmansville Fire Company has been the Game Dinner. And the Game Commission has been basically suggesting they can't do it. There's been some dialogue back and forth. I attended the Bowmansville Fire Company Monday night, and they suggested possibly the Board of Supervisors could have the township solicitor assist them. I said I would have, it would have to be a majority vote from the Bowmansville Fire Hall. They took that vote, and they asked me to bring before this board and possibly ask if this board would authorize our township solicitor to put the resources in to assist the Bowmansville Fire Company in trying to find the legal issues of this game dinner, their largest fundraiser that's being threatened to be shut down because there seems to be some misunderstanding and misinterpretation back and forth between the fire company and the game commissioner, and they desire some legal assistance to help them get some clarification on this.
I make that motion that we permit our attorney to assist the Bowmansville Fire Company.
I second it. Then okay. With comment.
Okay. I just want to ask Mr. Cassidy, is there any questions you have concerning that? Do you understand?
Is there a contact at the fire company that I can speak with
to get
some of the background?
We can get you one.
Okay.
Somebody
from the game commission that you've been talking with.
Correct.
Okay,
we had a motion. It was second, and you want to make a comment?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, you going to vote on it?
We can do the vote first. Yeah. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries.
Mr. Cassidy, I can provide you the pamphlets. It's the Fleetwood area. They have a wild game supper every year, a huge, huge one. Last year I supplied them with, it was close to 60 pounds of ground hamburger from deer. I have supplied them with bunches and bunches of raccoon meat. They charge $35 a person to eat there. They are booked out every year. How can they do it and ours not do it?
What's the deal with the game commission?
I don't know. That's why I can.
That's why I wanted to find
that's,
out.
That's where they're getting stonewalled. They're getting different reports. They're saying something is a law has been effective.
There's a new guy currently in sheriff in town. Yeah. The guy that.
Just state your name. So.
Mike Lehman from Deputy Chief of Overland.
Okay.
Wayne's actually the one I was in contact with him, but he couldn't be here tonight. From what I understand, this, one of the new wardens that's in charge now, this whole thing started with, you've probably seen in the paper, back in Lititz, when this restaurant got busted for some illegal game they had in the restaurant. Well, our game supper was like 2 weeks after this, and I think somebody somewhere said, hey, well, if we got busted, how come they can do it? And that just started a, and it just kept going, and then it kind of got ugly, and they said they were going to shut us down and everything else, but, you know, we were always under the assumption, we had discussed that with the game commission years ago, and they said there's been a law in the books ever since, I don't know, 1950 or something. You know, we can do it because most of our game, well, all of our game is coming from, you know, outside the state. So there's really nothing our game commission can enforce
right.
because it's not PA game. Mm-hmm. You know, and there's ways around that, you know. There's other companies, there's other places that do wild game stuff, and I know they, you know, they have like a raffle, and they sell a raffle ticket, and you get a free meal with it, you know. So there's different ways around and stuff, but we need some legal help, you know, and maybe to try to...
This pamphlet I'm talking about, one of the things that might make the difference, people doing this wild game supper, and I know them well, they're members of the Raja and the Shrine. I'm not so sure that it depends who you are politically, you can do things other people can't.
That's right.
Yeah, I believe that.
Well, that's where they, we've given Mr. Cassidy permission to assist them and try to help resolve and give them some legal advice.
Is your dinner coming up?
It will be in January.
So there really is not a law against it.
Depends who you ask, I guess.
That's
you know,
what they need help with.
The new warden is trying to push his weight around and stuff, and you know, but we were always under the assumption that everything we were doing was legal, and there's nothing wrong with what we're doing, so.
Right.
But our attempts lately to try to get back to this guy from the game commission, he never calls us back or, you know, no response from him whatsoever, so we're kind of, you know, we're almost at the point where, you know, if we don't hear something from him,
do it.
We might have to go over his head, maybe Harrisburg or something, so I don't know.
You know what happens when you do that?
Well,
yeah.
I went over heads already. I went straight to Harrisburg to David Overcash. The door flew open of my barn the next morning. They were standing out there like Wyatt Earp guys with pistols and telling me, don't you ever go over my head again or if it, you know what's good for you. They didn't know there was people in the next room stepped up the steps. They shut up then. But they threatened me.
Well, that's what we just need, you know.
Okay.
And like you say, depending on who you are, you get away with more, you know, other groups can, so, and we just need some legal, and, you know, that would be greatly appreciated. So.
Okay. Sure. Consider it done. Okay, the next item on our new business is the foreign fire insurance premium distribution.
We get the check sent to us from the state, and we have to disperse it to the fire companies.
Okay.
We give, in the past, we've given 10% of it to Adamstown Fire Company for the portion that they serve our township, and the remaining balance goes to, both fire companies have one fund. It's called the Brecknock Volunteer Firemen's Relief Association.
So you need a motion to distribute the funds as...
Yes.
I make a motion that we distribute the funds, the 10% to the Adamstown Fire Company, which is in the amount of $4,316.
No.
No, 10% of that.
This is, here it is. That's what Adamstown is.
Okay, $4,795.84. And the rest of the money remaining to be distributed between our two fire companies.
It's one fund. It goes into one fund. They manage it, yeah.
I'll second that.
Okay, we had the motion to distribute the fire company premiums, and it was second. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Mr. Lowell.
Yes.
If I could make a comment on that, just to clarify to the community members on where that funds comes from. Those funds are actually, it's called the PA Firemen's Relief Association, and there's actually a thick book that has guidelines on how the fire companies are able to spend that money. So it is just not money that we freely have the chance to just use at our disbursement. It is, there's definitely some classifications and some definite documentation that we need to hold, and our books obviously get audited by the state because it theoretically is the state's money. The township has, I believe, 30 or 60 days to hand that money over. And
60.
It is,
60.
The money is derived from homeowners in Pennsylvania or in our territory that actually get outside state fire insurance. And then we can then get that money. But
is it used, correct me if I'm wrong, but is it used for apparatus for your trucks and stuff
like
that?
Used, certain? We use, the majority of it is used for training funds, safety, exactly, some safety equipment, and obviously some of the equipment on the trucks.
And we do get a copy of that audited report here at the township every year.
If the township would like to see it, we'd be happy to give it to them. But
we have one.
I just want to clarify where that money is derived from.
Okay, our last item on our new business is Reams Disposal applying for their yearly salvage license renewal.
I'll make that motion that we approve their salvage license renewal. They were inspected and came out very good.
I second.
Okay.
I second.
The motion was made and seconded to approve the salvage application for Reams to continue to operate. And it was second, and those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries. Okay, that concludes our meeting. Is there a motion to adjourn?
Make that motion.
I second.
Okay, the motion was made and seconded to adjourn. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.